So there's been a lot of talk about communism and socialism lately in the world, and I was asking somebody I know who's a historian, what's with all these socialist discussions post Bernie Sanders? Like, where did this come from? And his simple response was, socialism never went away. It changes in number of followers, but it's never gone away. The same way that the communist movement in America used to be much larger and now it's smaller. These things never go away. They're just, they change in number of followers. But one of the big reasons why that I never hear anybody talking about when it comes to something like communism and socialism is dominance and the sort of dominance hierarchies associated with them. I mean, Jordan Peterson talked a lot about dominance hierarchies, right? Like people just sort themselves out into dominance hierarchies. People and lobsters, right? So it's like, just like no matter what, when you have a large group of people, it's going to form its own dominance hierarchy. So that's one of the things where I just always recognized that to have a sort of communist setup, it is initially flawed from the beginning because, Karl Marx was all about removing class. And that is the first time I've ever read anything associated with Marxism. It was just that sentence, creating a classless society. But if you were to try and do that, you will not remove the dominance hierarchies. And then won't groups still form? Yes. Won't dominance hierarchies still form? Yes. And then won't dominance hierarchies just move? Like, won't the most dominant person in the group just move the society to their advantage? Yes. So you're just going to have a form of dominance that's going to be more hidden and more unseen, and then it's just going to be sort of one of the largest ruling forces in the society because you won't have any other of the other supporting factors that we would have under a system like capitalism. It's like you don't actually have the ability to earn unlimited wealth, and you wouldn't have the ability to, well, you might not even have the right to vote if you're in a place like North Korea or China or something. You would just be solely reliant on the most dominant will that is forcing, the society to its advantage. Because one of the largest things to say is that is an inevitable reality. If you were actually to create a classless society, you would have a sort of more reliance on the dominance hierarchies. Another reason to talk about these things, about why they won't work, is anonymity. I was listening to Tom Hartman, of all people, who is, I guess, an anti-capitalist, but he said that one of the reasons why communism would never work is that it has to, I mean, human beings don't follow that stuff. Whenever you sort of have the ability to do something anonymously, the whole communist things fall apart. Like this whole notion of equality and you want everything to be equal for everyone. As soon as you can do that stuff without getting caught, as soon as you're able to hide your actions, as soon as you're able to do something without other people knowing, people do things, and then people will make things unequal. And once again, it just depends on how sneaky and bizarre and your levels of trickery, and those are going to be the things that are going to be moving things to its advantage, like deception and cheating and maneuvering the system. Like, the people are already going to be weak because they have so many limitations forced upon them, and then they're going to have, but they're going to be overrun by people who just have their ability to manipulate the system. And you wouldn't have all the sort of things that you could fall back on in something such as capitalism, whereas, we have lots of separations and powers of checks and balances. I don't mean like checks and balances like executive, legislative, and judicial. No, I mean the other checks and balances, like the electorate, like, having a vote, and, also the other things, like, the markets versus the government, and also even some things like, people have talked in the past about institutions such as like the churches and the houses of worship. Is we have separation of church and state, right? That's just another thing that the government cannot get their hands on. We have all sorts of things that are, involved with the powers of checks and balances. And let's not even talk about the Second Amendment. I mean, like, that's another thing, that's another form of checks and balances in itself. When it's like, does China have firearms for its citizens? No. Does North Korea have firearms for its citizens? Not to my knowledge. So it's like, we have all sort of these things that we can put forth in a capitalist society like America, where we aren't going to have, you know, all the drawbacks of socialism and communism. Now, everything that we've talked about has been very relevant to a discussion on communism, but what do we do about socialism? More importantly, democratic socialism. Bernie Sanders was very clear, and I listened to Bernie from time to time, and in one of his speeches, I believe it was the one at Georgetown University, he just said, democratic socialism is the people make decisions in the government that benefit the people. It's like, you have a government that's on the side of, you know, just sort of like the working class, as opposed to the billionaires and the top 1%, as he would say. But one of the things about that is, for starters, I mean, you actually have to have people who genuinely believe that, and they aren't going to try and do any sort of unequal thing without other people knowing. And that goes back to the exact same principle. People aren't going to defend the working class if they can get away with it, if they can do it without getting caught. They're going to defend themselves and their own financial interests and their own power interests. And why doesn't anyone refer to Bernie Sanders as a power-hungry politician? He tried to be president, did he not? He goes on TV every chance he gets, did he not? He's a career politician, is he not? So it's like, he's just a power-hungry politician like anybody else. And furthermore, I mean, as soon as people can make things unequal, they're going to make things unequal. And if you just want to say that we're going to have this perfectly equal society, that's only going to last as long as, you know, the dominance hierarchy allows it to, which is about 5 seconds. Because if everything is just equal for everyone, then the more dominant personalities are just going to move things to their advantage, and they're just going to be sort of a larger, more controlling force. And we don't want that. And that's bad, because we want to have people to have rights that they can fall back on. And, you know, if we're going to talk about some other socialist things, you know, like things about, you know, what socialized medicine, socialized education, whatever you would want to call it. Well, let's look at it from this way. I went through a lot of, you know, political trash talk over my lifetime. You know, I'm in my 30s now. And the biggest thing that I can just sort of come away with is, like, somebody once said, and I won't say his name because he's kind of a cunt, but, like, he sort of said, you know, the government doesn't even really create a policy. The government is horribly unorganized, and it has to respond to changes all up and down. You got this problem here, you have that problem there, you need to prevent a problem here. The government has to respond to changes all across the board. The government doesn't create the policy. The political climate creates the policy. Now, it's like, that's just one of those things when it's like, you actually have to alter the political climate if you're ever going to make any sort of positive change in society. Don't get me wrong, I am not a pessimist, I am an optimist. I mean, I can even be an idealist. Let's strive toward the ideal. Yeah, peace on earth and love for everyone, sure. I want all those things too. But the way you go about it isn't just by signing petitions, and it isn't by just writing your congressperson so they can send you an automated response. It's like, that's not really the best way to go about these things. What is a much larger way that we can do it is, if you want something, create a market for it. Now, this is a getting away from medicine, but Scott Adams, of all people, you know, just had one of the best takes on green energy that I ever heard, when he was just like, when it comes to, you know, green energy versus fossil fuels, he's like, things like that get solved because of markets. The only way to have anything like green energy is to create a market for it. I mean, like, and you know what? He's right. You can shake a protest sign at Big Oil all you want and say, hey, Shell, please don't drill in the Arctic. Is that actually going to do anything? What you really should do is, you know, try to find a way to make green energy more marketable and, you know, a better financial option and economic option than drilling in the Arctic, maybe then Shell would actually have an incentive. Is that easy? No. Is that, you know, really, really fucking difficult? Yes. But that's just sort of the only way that we can actually go about these things. Otherwise, it's just not going to happen. Because one of the things that the socialists and the communists and the democratic socialists, even if you want to call them that, is they don't really quite get is that they just want people to sort of intentionally weaken their businesses just because they say so. And, you know, Michael Moore's early films were all about this, especially he did that film The Big One when he was just kind of like going to companies and like ask them, hey, why are you sending jobs overseas? And they're like, because we want to save money, you know, like, all right, so then we need to find ways to make, you know, the market more attractive so they would stay in here. And this can be done in a variety of ways. The politicians talk about it every cycle. The newscasters and the, you know, debate shows get all into the ways, you know, about how you would make something like that possible. But that's the answer. It's not just saying, hey, you shouldn't do that because that's not nice. You know, like, that's what the people don't quite understand. Socialism and communism aren't nice. Socialism and communism are not friendly. Socialism and communism aren't actually going to work because no one is actually going to be playing by these rules. As soon as they're able to deceive and lie and cheat and not get caught, they're going to. And that's just going to create a whole realm of inequalities that are unforeseen in any sort of socialist or communist projections. Moreover, you know, it's like, you don't really want, you know, things to be determined by these very natural, arbitrary elements like a dominance hierarchy. So when we have things like socialism and communism, the real answer is to just say no. And when you want something like universal health care, well, you should try to find a way to get every person health care by using a market. Or at the very least, you can sort of, you know, look at something about how, you know, government and businesses could work together. You know, when the state and local level, this is often done with things like tax credits, and you know, they also have some sort of, you know, ways to manipulate the system as well. But just to say a blanket statement, you want universal health care for everyone, I mean, okay, I'm sure that you do, but one of the ways that you would want to go about it is find a way to make it more attractive to the market, or, you know, come up with a plan or something. Green energy as well, not to mention that the political climate doesn't give a flying fuck about what any single person's feelings are. The government doesn't have feelings, and the political climate doesn't have feelings, so they aren't going to respond, you know, to emotional pleas. The only thing that they're going to respond to is if there is a new market that's going to create more economic prosperity that will alleviate the tension. Well, that's all I can really say about that, and those are just some of the short reasons why I think communism and socialism will never work. And I would hope that, you know, we can at least have some sort of discussion going on about ways to sort of reinvent capitalism into sort of a new capitalism, or look at some of the, you know, works and writings of people like Alexander Hamilton and Henry Clay, who had plans for government, but sort of worked in the American system of political economy, which, you know, the advocates for that in the 21st century still identify as capitalist. There are a wide range of possibilities that we can do without abandoning capitalism and taking on these sort of, you know, kind of impractical notions of socialism and communism, which intentionally have to weaken their own economies to account for arbitrary distribution measures. Remember, there is no pay your fair share of taxes. I mean, no one really got to decide that. That is purely an arbitrary decision. What you could say instead is, you know, find a sort of, you know, way to make it the market more appealing that would lift up a larger portion of the population, because otherwise you're just sort of telling people that, you know, hey, you need to do something because I want it, and they're not going to listen. The same reason that other people in socialist and communist settings wouldn't listen if they could do something without paying any consequences. Until next time.